When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to
Amen.
Good to see you today.
How many of you are glad to be here today? Amen. All right. How many of you are tired of COVID-19? Okay, I was trying to see if any hand didn't go up. We have a problem if somebody's not tired of COVID-19. Well, things have been different, and we are kind of maintaining what we're doing here for morning worship. We're not having Sunday school, we're not having Sunday school classes on Sunday mornings for anyone, so just morning worship. And we do have a men's class that does meet in the fellowship hall on Tuesday nights at 6 o'clock, so we're doing that. I think the youth are meeting Sunday morning and Wednesday night. So, and they're being careful about what they do. So, but until things change, we're just going to continue what we're doing until we are able to move forward, and then we'll let you know when that time comes. Have a prayer request for you this morning, but I wanted to share with you that Tope, her birthday is today, but that's not the prayer request. I know she's over 65 because she's on Medicare, but that's as far as I'll go with that. But I mentioned Tope not only because her birthday is today, but because there is a prayer request on her behalf. You know, Tope has spent a couple days in the hospital because she began having back pain. And what they discovered was is that she has an abdominal mass. It's kind of around her kidney and even wrapped around a main artery to her kidney. So she had a biopsy done this past week. And what they are categorizing that as is a low-grade lymphoma. So she will have a PET scan this week, and then we'll meet with the oncologist to decide on a plan of treatment for her. She's not in the hospital now. She's staying with Eddie, so she's close over there to the hospital and to the doctor for that upcoming appointment and so forth. So be in prayer for her, because we don't know where this is going to go or what the treatments are going to consist of. So she asked for prayer. They probably need to go out on the prayer chain, and if you need me to text you all that information, I will, and then we can send that out so the rest of the church can know about that. All right, would you bow as we go to the Lord in prayer and ask His blessing upon our time together for worship, and then for Miss Tope as well.
Happy day. And sometimes you wonder whether you need to be singing or not singing, so I'm going to say, sing. Happy day. Thank you. Everybody awake out there? Let's stand up and sing 10,000 Reasons.
Like never before.
us in prayer.
Sometimes we don't see how they could. Struggles that break our hearts in two sometimes blind us to the truth. Our Father knows what's best for us. His ways are not our own. So when your pathway grows dim and you just don't see Him, remember you're never alone. God is too God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. Our future in His hand. So don't live as those who have no hope. All our hope is found in Him. We see the present clearly. And like a tapestry, He's weaving you and me to one day be just like Him. God is too wise to be mistaken, and God is too to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. He alone is faithful and true, and He alone knows what is best for you. God is too wise to be mistaken, and God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. When you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. Trust His heart.
You'll take your Bibles today and turn to the Old Testament book of Joshua, chapter 3. Today I want to talk about being ready for what's next. Joshua chapter 3. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 5, but let me just give a little bit of background. As the book of Joshua begins in Joshua chapter 1, we've already looked at that a couple of weeks ago. We know that Moses, a great servant of God that led the nation for a long time, had just died, and God had selected Joshua to succeed Moses and then to lead the nation into the promised land to take possession of it. And God instructs Joshua to lead the nation across the Jordan River and then into that land that he was giving to them. And as he did, he gave Joshua some great promises, and he gave Joshua some great encouragement and assurance to do exactly what God had told him to do. Now, when you get to chapter 3 begins by giving us the details of the nation moving to the Jordan River to cross over into that land which God had promised to give them. And we're going to look at verses 1 through 5. And beginning in verse 1, the Bible says that then Joshua rose early in the morning, and they set out from Acacia Grove and came to the Jordan, he and all the children of Israel, and lodged there before they crossed over. So it was after 3 days that the officers went through the camp, and they commanded the people, saying, "When you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests, the Levites, bearing it, then you shall set out from your place and go after it. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits in measure. Do not come near it, that you may know the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way before." Joshua said to the people, "Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." You can go to the next slide. You know, for the nation of Israel, this had been quite a long journey. They had been delivered from Egyptian bondage. They had gone through the Red Sea. They had come up to the portals of the land of promise, but due to the nation's distrust in God and because of their disobedience, the nation was sent back through the wilderness to wander for another 40 years until all of those who were age 20 and over died in that wilderness, for the exception of Joshua and Caleb. They were the only two, 20 and older, who made it. But now the nation has returned. This younger generation has grown up in 40 years, and they're at the bank of the Jordan, and they're, you know, ready to do something, either to cross over or not. So they stand at the door of an opportunity, and it is a time of decision. They will either trust God and obey God and follow His leadership, and they will cross over the Jordan and do what God had commanded them to do and take possession of the land, or they could be like their parents and that other generation who didn't trust God and who didn't obey and do what God said. You know, in a similar way, we sometimes stand at the threshold of a new beginning, of a new opportunity. That happens in all of our lives in various ways. And there are always times in our lives that are times of decision, that we must come to a point to where we decide if we'll go forward with God and do what God says and be obedient to God and trust Him, or if we choose a different path. Concerning our own nation, we don't know what's going to happen in the next several months to the end of the year. We don't know how it's all going to play out. We all have some suspicions and thoughts about what that might look like, but we really don't know. But I believe that regardless of what happens, we have some principles here that I think are some very important principles that we need to take heed of, that we need to apply to our own life, not only as a church, but especially as Christians that represent the Lord Jesus Christ in a world of change and uncertainty and in the midst of a divided nation. So I want to share with you several principles this morning from this passage. And principle number one is this, and that is we must choose to live by faith instead of being dominated by fear. There are a lot of things going on in our world. There are a lot of things going on in our country. There may be a lot of things going on in your own life and in your own family. There's just a lot of things going on. Now, when you have things going on in your own family and in your own life, personally, and then your family, and then maybe your friends, that extends out, and then you look at the nation and what chaos is going on around us, the temptation is to succumb to fear, to have a fearful heart. God doesn't want us to live that way. Now, in verse 1, the Bible says that Joshua rose in the morning and he set out from Acacia Grove and he came to the Jordan. And all the children of Israel along with him, and it says they lodged there before they crossed over. And so this, for Joshua and the nation of Israel, was a day of opportunity. There could have been things to fear like their forefathers did, because the same things that were there when the 12 spies went in were still there when they came back 40 years later. The same obstacles, the same challenges that were before them. And so this was a day of opportunity, a day of decision, but it would require faith. Faith in God to overcome any fears, to move into the unknown. You see, some of us today are facing some unknowns. We don't know what this is. We don't know where this is going to go. We don't know what the outcome of whatever this is. You fill in the blank. And so there are unknowns. We're moving into some areas in our own country that is the unknown. We've never been here before, and we don't know exactly what's going to take place. And so there are a lot of fearful things that we face in life. It may be like a phone call I had last night. It may be related, to your health. It may be related to the health of someone that you love. It may be related to job security or some kind of trying circumstance or trial in your life. The unknown about the future or the things that are happening all around us. But God calls us, in spite of what's going on, He calls us to live and to walk by faith, doesn't He? He says, walk by faith, not by fear. Not by what you see and not by what you hear and not what's on the television, not what's on the radio, not by all the feelings that might be stirred within you, but to walk and to live by faith. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 7 says, we walk by faith and not by sight. Colossians 2 and verse 6 says, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him. Hebrews 11 and verse 6 says, without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who sincerely seek Him. But the devil wants to interject fear into our hearts. He'll use anything he can, and he will get you to spend, or try to get you to spend time thinking about all the negatives and talking about all the negatives. Have you ever got caught up in doing that? And you get caught up in all the things that are happening, all the negatives and all the bad things that are happening and all the things that might happen, all the things that could go wrong, that might go wrong and probably will go wrong, and all the terrible possibilities, and your heart gets filled with fear, and And when that happens, you become spiritually paralyzed. And if you're not careful, you'll have a nervous breakdown. But I want you to think about what Jesus said. Think about all the times that Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not fear." How many times has he said that? How many times did he say that to you and to me? Do not fear. Do not fear. In John 14, 27, for example, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Isaiah 41 in verse 10, God says this, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And it sounds similar to what the Lord told Joshua. You think back to Joshua chapter 1 in verse 7. God said, "This is my command, Joshua. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." You ever forget that? Wherever you are, wherever you go, the Lord your God is with you. And the Bible says, "Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world." Greater is he who is in us, the Lord Jesus Christ, than anything that is in the world. And so, like Joshua and the nation of Israel, we will come to obstacles in life that we've got to deal with. We've situations, trials, circumstances that we have to overcome. If we're going to keep moving forward, if we're going to be where God wants us to be, go where God wants us to go, and accomplish what God wants us to accomplish, then we've got to overcome the obstacles in life. And so we have to choose either to be dominated by fear or to overcome and to live by faith. Maybe that's where you are today. That's the struggle. That's the challenge. Maybe you bounce between one or the other. It's fear or faith. It's faith or fear. You can't have both at the same time. The Bible says we're to walk by faith and we're to keep moving forward by faith that we may go where God wants us to go in life. Not just physically, but also spiritually in life, to be what he wants us to be and do what he's called us to do. Well, that's very important, that we live by faith instead of being dominated by fear. But what helps us to do that? Here's the second principle. And that is that we keep our focus on the Lord and his will for our life and refuse to get sidetracked. There's a lot of things in life today that will seek to distract you. There's a lot of things out there today that can cause you to easily be distracted. And if you're not careful, you'll be consumed and spend your time on a lot of certain things that will sidetrack you from the Lord. Joshua chapter 3, verses 2 through 4, it says that after 3 days, the officers went through the camp and they told the people, "When you see the ark of the covenant, when you see the ark, move forward. The priests and the Levites will bear it, and you'll see it as it begins to move. Keep a space between it. Don't crowd up all around it, but keep a good distance from it, and everyone to be able to see it. And as you see it, when it moves, you move. You follow it." Because here's what he said, and here's the reason: that you may know the way by which you must go. See, God told Joshua and the nation, "All right, here's how this is going to work, and here's how I'm going to do it. You need to know exactly when you need to go and where you need to go. And this is how I'm going to lead you. But in order for me to lead you at the right time to the right place, you must have a focus. Now, in this instance, you must focus on the Ark of the Covenant. You must watch it and be alert. And when that begins to move, then you begin to move. And wherever it goes, you go. And you follow it. Now, why? Why follow it? Well, that you may know by the way in which you must go. And here's the reason. He said, for you have not passed this way before. This is something new. You've not been here. This is new territory. And as you begin to move, when you cross over, it's going to be all, it's all new ball game. You've not been here before. And so they were moving into the unknown. What awaits them? What's going to be expected of them? Where is the Lord going to lead them? What's the Lord going to do? How difficult might it be? What kind of changes are going to be required, are going to be necessary? What kind of struggles or difficulties or obstacles or challenges are going to be over there on the other side? What's going to be required? What kind of sacrifices might we have to make? And so, you see, for them, it was very important that they stay focused on God and trust Him in order for God's plan to be fulfilled in their lives. And I think that's a lot to be said for us as well. We've got to be focused on the Lord and keep our focus on God. There are so many things, as I said, that will distract us, that will sidetrack us, that will get our thoughts and our minds and our attention on all kinds of things. I mean, how much time have you spent lately watching the news or listening to talk radio? Anybody identify? Does anybody have the Fox app on your, Fox News app on your phone? Anybody? Anybody want to admit that? You got some kind of app on your phone, perhaps? Some kind of way of getting news? You're not careful. You're sitting there, you hit that every day. And then it's an article. It's an article about this, what the president is doing, and what Pelosi and Schumer are saying, and what the Congress is doing, and what they're not doing, and they're at a stalemate, and this one blames this, and this one blames that, and they're not getting this done, and all this stuff going on. And you read it, and you read it, and you read it, and you read it, and there's an article, and then you read on, and then you find out of all the things that's going on in our country, and wacky people doing weird things. It's like, man, what has gotten into people? It's just unbelievable what is going on. And before you know it, you've spent about an hour or 2 hours of your time thinking, wow, where did my time go? Being absorbed in all this stuff, and you have all these emotions and feelings that go with that. And then you begin talking about it or sharing with somebody else about it and talking about it. Hey, did you hear about this? Man, why such a... And all this stuff goes on. And I've told you before that we and I've said it several times, but, you know, we need more of the good. We get plenty of the bad news. We need more of the good news. We don't need to get so sidetracked and all that. I don't say not to be informed. I like to be informed. I like to know what's going on. And I'm going to stay informed, but I don't want to get sidetracked. And so we must be careful that we spend time with the Lord to know what He wants us to do, what He wants us to be, how He wants us to live, that we might know how to approach this the situations that come against us. We have to learn to be flexible as well and know how to adapt to the situations. And I want to say this, and I think this is very important. We never, 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 never compromise on principle. We never compromise on truth. We never compromise on the Word of God. Yeah, people are doing it all over the place, but my friends, we're not to do that. We're to stand on principle. We're to sway on preferences. Don't compromise on the standard, on the truth, but you can and must compromise on preferences. That's important because when you and I stand on principles that are based on the Word of God, we are going to be opposed by those who don't like our principles. And my friends, listen, we're seeing that all over our country. We're seeing that as it begins to now infiltrate and come against the church. Principles are being challenged. What we believe is being challenged. And I think that's going to continue to grow. But that's not something that we should be shocked by, because Jesus warned us about it. Paul warned us about it. Peter warned us about it. Let me give you some examples. Jesus said in John 15, he said, "If the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. The world would love you if you belonged to the world, if you were its own. But you are no longer part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you. Do you remember what I told you? A slave is not greater than his master. Since they persecuted me, naturally they will persecute you." Now, how many of us in this building identify with the Lord Jesus Christ? How many of us say, "The Lord Jesus Christ is my Savior"? How many of us would say, "I have placed my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. He died on the cross for my sins, and He is the only way into heaven"? Is that what we believe? Is that what we stand on? If we identify with Jesus, Jesus said in John 15, verse 21, "They will do all this to you because of me." And when our world and when our government and when leaders and those in authority, when they hate Jesus and they hate the Word of God, they're going to hate you if you love Jesus, belong to Jesus, identify with Jesus, and believe the Word of God. Jesus said, "If they've done it to me, they will do it to you, for they have rejected the one who sent me." And I'm telling you, we hear it all the time, this great resentment, this great rejection of Jesus Christ and who He is. Such is our day. Paul said the same thing. He said, we live in a day when people are going to just, they're going to be lovers of themselves, they're going to be lovers of money, they're going to be boastful and proud, they're going to scoff at God, they're going to be disobedient to parents, they're going to be ungrateful, they will not consider anything sacred. They're going to be unloving, unforgiving, they're going to slander others, and they're going to have no self-control. This is 2 Timothy chapter 3. He said that they're going to be cruel, they're going to hate what is good, they will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. Such is the day in which we live. John 16, 33, Jesus said, "I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace." Now, in this world, Jesus said, you're going to have trouble, you're going to have tribulation. But He said, "Take heed, be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world." So, yeah, all this stuff happens, and it's going to happen. We're told about it. It's been prophesied, predicted, and we've been told ahead of time, but the Lord said, don't live in fear. Don't be afraid. Be strong. Be courageous. Take heart, because I have overcome the world. And so, you and I must stand on principle. We must sway on certain preferences. We must be willing to be able to be flexible and adapt to change. You'll notice in verses 3 and 4 that the Israelites were told to keep their eyes on the ark and to follow it through the Jordan into their new beginning. He said that you may know by which way you should go, and you have not passed this way before. Now, in that particular day that we read about in this text, the Ark of the Covenant served as a visible sign of the presence of God. It was a visible sign that God was leading them, and they were to follow the ark as the ark moved. So the Israelites' job was really pretty simple. You watch the ark. When the ark moves, you move. Wherever it goes, you go. When the ark stops, you stop. When it moves, you move. You just have to keep your focus on the Ark of the Covenant. I think that's really pretty good news and advice for us as well. We don't keep our eyes on the Ark of the Covenant like that, but we're to keep our focus on the Lord. He has given us His Word, and He has given us the Holy Spirit, and you and I are to keep our focus on Him. We're not to move ahead of Him, but we're not to get sidetracked or distracted, and we're not to fall behind. We're to stay close to Him. And I'll tell you why we even need to be more close to Him as ever before is because we may be headed into some things that we have never encountered before. We may be headed into some areas of life in which we have never experienced before. We as a people, we even as a nation living in this country as Christians, we may be encountering a future that we've never had to face before. So what I'm telling you is we've just got to spiritually alert and keep our focus upon the Lord and not be sidetracked. Here's the last principle, number three, and that is we've got to stay true to God's Word and remain faithful to Him no matter what. Stay true to Him, what He says in His Word, and be faithful no matter what. There's going to be a lot of things that challenge us throughout our Christian life. There's going to be good, but there's going to be bad. There's going to be trials. There's going to be challenges. There's going to be things that's going to happen that we don't know where it came from. And there's going to be things that's going to happen that we don't understand why. And we don't know exactly what to expect, and we don't know where this is going to take us from this point forward. Joshua said to the people, "Sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you." Joshua said, God's going to move, and God's going to do something. And God's going to do something that's going to be a wonder among you. So he said, so be ready for that. So you need to sanctify yourselves. You know, all of us that call ourselves Christians, we are called by the Lord to commit ourselves to stay pure in our minds, to stay pure in our motives, and to stay pure in our actions. And I would tell you, this is very challenging in the day in which we live, with all that we have access to and all the technology and all the rest. It seems like almost everything pulls us in the opposite direction of God. And you have to be determined in purpose to stay true to God, because it won't happen by drifting. It won't happen by accident. It happens on purpose when you set your mind to it. Joshua said, sanctify yourself. The word sanctify means to be separated. It means to be set apart as holy. We are to be committed to the Lord, faithful to Him, and set apart from the world unto Him. And I want to ask you as we close, would the word faithful, what that word contains, would that be a word that would characterize your relationship with God? Would you say, I am faithful in my relationship with God? Would the word faithful characterize your service for the Lord? That I am faithful to what He's called me to do. Would the word faithful characterize your Christian life as you live your life wherever you may be, at home or at work or wherever you go? Would the word faithful characterize your Christian life? We're going to put this last screen up. I'm going to ask Angela to come, and she's just going to play something very quietly as we have just a moment of reflection. But you know, God can still do great things in your life, in my life, and God can do great things even in this church, if we will simply trust him and stay faithful to him. We'll trust him and stay faithful. God can still do great things. Do you trust him? And will you be faithful? Can I ask you to bow your heads just for a moment? Heads bowed, eyes closed. You think about the word faithful. You say you're faithful to the Lord. You're faithful as a Christian. Are you living your life in fear or in faith? Is there anything in your life today that you need to get right with the Lord? Anything you need to turn over to him? Any worry that you have? Any doubt that you have? You need to turn over to the Lord. Would you do that today?